All right, well, look, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for being here. The slide that you didn't get to see because we skipped straight past it said the future of mobility. So I'm going to give you 6 or 7 minutes of Teralytics view of the future of mobility, starting with who we are. And my name is Alastair MacLeod. I'm the CEO since 2017. For those older people in the room, I'm obviously doing something for the leadership demographic at NOAH. Okay, so this is what interests us, right? The fact that the way the world, the way people get around in the world is changing dramatically. And even if the genuine outlying article is the 52-year-old CEO of Teralytics now likes to get around Zurich on an electric scooter, which is my preferred way of getting around. But that's, of course, that's going to be big, but that's not the really big thing. We've got, you know, we're moving from combustion engines to electric vehicles. We're moving from driven to autonomous. We move from individual ownership to shared ownership. And if you're a car manufacturer right now, you've got to figure out, you know, what are you going to do when people stop buying cars? And that really isn't very far away, as we know with some of the people that we're working with. So huge changes coming in the way we get around the planet. And existing transportation systems, for the most part, just aren't keeping up. If you went back and you looked in a sort of a time series over the last 2-3 decades, at the rate of change, like how have people changed their behavior, changed their living patterns, switched to different modes of mobility, you'd find nothing particularly interesting to look at. But that's led to some significant underlying problems that are going to start to come to bite us. So for example, in the last 25 years, to take a snapshot, the ridership of the New York transit system has increased by 58%. But during that time, the rolling stock is the same, the tracks are the same. I imagine by the time you overlay operational constraints, probably the actual capacity of the system has gone down, right? And that's also got to take into account big changes in things like living patterns. When I was younger, I lived in London when I was, you know, young and foolish, but I couldn't wait to get out of London to have a home and a garden and a family. And now the guys that I work with, they all want to live in cities, and that's changing as well. And we have got all these new sort of forms of mobility. Even if we're not there yet with autonomous, we are there with micro-mobility, scooters and so on. We are there with ride-sharing, of course. And you know, if you think we're sort of moving from the old world, planes, trains, automobiles, and the occasional bus, and now we've got all this to deal with. You know, the old stuff is still there and kind of fighting for its life, but now you've got to factor in ride-share and car-share and shuttles and autonomous vehicles and so on. You know, how that whole thing is going to kind of work together is not at all clear to anybody, but actually authorities are having to deal with it already. And the kind of the most well-known example is Manhattan slapping a limit on the number of Uber licenses it would issue. But in truth, nobody really knows, did that make it better or did it make it worse? And actually, the answer is could be either, but at the minute, the ability just doesn't exist to knit all this stuff together or even to see across all mobility to know what's going on. So, quickly about us, we just actually just closed around, or we're just closing around, so this isn't an investment pitch, this is a post-investment light relief, but this is what we do. So what you're seeing here is the data that we process to create graphs of human mobility. So this is data from telecom networks. We have nothing to do with individual data, so we, you know, everywhere we operate in the world, we are GDPR or higher, but we simply don't deal in individual data. What we do is, I always describe it to people as if you imagine looking down from space, someone has helpfully painted an orange dot on everybody's head. What you would see is lots of orange dots moving around the planet, and that's fundamentally what we see. We don't know who owns the dot. We never will. We don't want to, actually. And then we just add one more layer, which is we block up individual traces just to make sure that you could never find a red dot. But this is what we do. That's the big data that we process. It's a genuine big data company. We're processing around 40 billion data points a day, working in 10 markets, and we're serving all of the people I just described at the first part of the presentation. So cities, authorities, transport operators, car manufacturers, smart mobility providers, those are the people we sell to. I mention this just for this is if you like if you're going to take away from this one point of distinction between us and everybody else who says they have interesting information about how humans move around the planet, this is ultimately where we come from. Right? The more or less every data sample you'll ever lay your hands on that has something to do with, you know, how do humans get around, it's almost certainly small. If you capture 3 or 4% of the population, you've already done well. It's absolutely guaranteed to be biased because usually it's sourced from applications, and application choice by definition is biased. And in contrast, we see at least 20% of the population wherever we work, and we see that population 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, and we see each orange dot from space, we see each dot between 150 and 1,000 times a day. So we have the ability to chart a very comprehensive view of how humans get around. And this is the reason why we think telecom network data is absolutely the data to use when you are looking at this macro mobility picture. Like, how do I make my city work in 10 years' time when everything's been thrown up in the air? Cell towers don't discriminate, right? My father, heading now into his 80s, actually just got a smartphone, so this was a better anecdote before he did, but until about a year ago, he still had his old 6310 Nokia. So he would be excluded from every single GPS sample, as would people in society who can't afford to spend $800 on a smartphone, and so on and so on. So yes, technically, we still exclude people who don't have a smartphone, but the data is so huge that we're able to actually recreate the behavior of the whole population rather than just saying these are the 10 guys we can see, right? And that creates a very unbiased sample. That means when we say, here's how the population of New York is getting to work and here's how it's changed in the last 2 years, we're talking about the whole of the population, not just a handful of guys we can see. Okay, as I am expanding to fill the space, let me just come to a couple of examples to make it real, and then maybe some questions, right? So here's a couple of examples of kind of real world work that we have done now, and how does this sort of flying dots on a map turn into something valuable to our clients? This is the first one. We've now, I think we've made 3 different deals in electric vehicle, electric charging. Fundamentally, we help these guys with two significant kind of parts of the puzzle. Yeah, one is kind of infrastructure design, where the charging points need to be, and second is demand forecasting or capacity planning, if you like. Tempting to think that there's lots of car data around, so how hard can that be? But you have to keep coming back to this multimodal thing, right? It doesn't follow at all that the people who drive cars today will be the exact same people that will be driving electric vehicles tomorrow. There's going to be lots of modal shifts, and so looking at the whole population is critical, not just at the car data. This is the second one. For anybody who was at the there was an internet forum in Portugal last year, I think Volkswagen presented this. So we created a very large data set, which Volkswagen fed into a quantum computer. And the use case that was being demonstrated is using quantum computing in real time to forecast mobility demand. So if you picture the scene, I won't name the city, but picture the scene, significant European city X. That city's already said when autonomous vehicles come, they may not come into the city and just drive around the block because that's going to be really annoying. So they have to be out of a certain zone and then kind of come in when they're wanted, right? But if you try to square that with a service obligation, you need to put them in the right place so that when I press my button saying I want a car, it arrives in the right amount of time. So we did that with Volkswagen. So this is demand prediction, route optimization, and also sort of placement. Finally, and then I'll wrap up. Just to be absolutely clear as a disclaimer, this is not a client. This is an image taken from the web. I wouldn't want anybody who works for this company to think we were showcasing them. But this is the kind of extreme end of the spectrum of things are really changing. But we're already talking to 2 companies who are planning to do this. Mobility goes 3D. You know, taxis that will fly in the sky with nobody piloting them. I think most of these are going to launch already autonomous capable. They just won't be autonomous when they launch because we're not ready to get into a plane with no pilot. And with these guys, again, we're doing mobility prediction, but we're also doing kind of market planning and entry. Like where, if you're going to launch, it's a very big world out there, if you're going to launch 3 routes to start with, which country on the planet do you pick? Which route in the country do you pick? And to do that, you want to know most traveled routes. You want to know something about the people traveling those routes and so on, so that you're targeting the right customers with the popular segments. So there you go. So that's what we do. We're absolutely mobility data guys. I hope you found it interesting, and I will hand over to the moderator.